Mexican consulate. So everyone, please welcome Lilian, Cordoba, Vasquez, and Giselle, Zapata, Garcia.
I'm just gonna introduce myself a little bit. As Alex said, the head of the Community Outreach Department of the Consulate of Mexico here in Seattle. We have jurisdiction in Washington, 7 counties in Idaho, and the state of Alaska recently, because we had to close our office over there. So we were invited to let you know a little bit about the work we do, and I know this class is more focused on homelessness, but just the work that we do serving the vulnerable communities in our areas of reach. And Giselle, I'll let her introduce herself later on, but she's one of our key partners at the consulate. She works for Molina Healthcare, but she had also worked with the consulate before as the head of one of the programs that you're gonna hear from today, which is the Ventanilla de Salud, or the health window that we have at the consulate. And I mean, she's been a key partner wherever she has been in serving these communities. So, Giselle is gonna help me pass some booklets that you can check later on about the program. But I wanted to give you first a little insight on, or a special, some kind of picture of how we see the problem of immigrants and health. And the two examples that we're gonna talk about is the health window and the Latinos Promoting Good Health group. So the first thing that I'm gonna tell you, this is probably not very new for you. I'm gonna go over it kind of quickly. But I just wanted to show you, in the 60s, 70% of the immigrant population in the US, as you might know, was Europeans. And the following decades, the immigrant community has been growing pretty fast. So the Latin American Caribbean communities increased dramatically from 2000 on. And now they are over half of the immigration population. You can see over there, Latin American immigrants are the gray area, and the Asian community, which has also been growing, it's the red area adjacent to the Latin American community, but the growth has been considerable since the 2000s. Now, some of the numbers that I'm gonna tell you have been influenced also by a dramatic decrease on the number of Mexican nationals that have been coming to the US. I must say that this information is basically from Mexican citizens for obvious reasons. That's what we at the consulate study. But the Central American and other Latin American communities more or less follow the same behavior, so they have more or less the same numbers. We're pretty close, that's what I mean. But the Mexican population immigrating to the US is that black line that you can see on the left graphic. It's dropped dramatically recently. But the population of Mexican origin in the country is growing. US citizens, kids that are born here, but of Mexican parents. So there are currently 34.3 million persons of Mexican origin living in the US. They are, of course, the largest immigrant group. One in six Americans is Hispanic, Mexican, or from any other Latin American country. And it is projected that by 2050, it's gonna be one in three. So this is the universe of people that we work with in the 50 consulates that we have all over the US, which is the biggest network that any country has in another network in terms of consular offices and consular services, just because of the size of our population. In this following graphic, you can see more or less the distribution. That's nothing new either. The darkest red is the states with the biggest immigrant population. Obviously, is the border, where the family ties and the proximity geographically make it way easier to immigrate and to establish for immigrants. But maybe you can note the gray areas are the next big group of immigrant population. Washington is also growing a lot, as you can see, it's in, on the third level, let's say like that. And on the East Coast, which is traditionally the one with less immigrants from Mexico, there are also some states that have gone from white, almost no immigrants, to some communities that are establishing themselves there. So California and Texas remain the states, obviously, with the highest concentration, 37 and 22. And as I was saying, some states that are not traditional for immigration in Mexico, North Dakota, and Hawaii are the lowest. Now, a little bit about access to health insurance and the services that the community access. It is important to know that 6.2 million Mexican immigrants don't have insurance. There is many factors why there is many obstacles to these communities, the Mexican and the Latin American community, accessing services. One is the language barrier, of course, their immigration status, of course, and of course this reflects harshly on their conditions, health conditions, and the treatment of their illnesses or even prevention, so they end up using a lot of emergency services, which are more expensive and usually arrive late. So the numbers are, as you can see in the graphic, pretty steady, with a little peak in 2007, but then after Obamacare, there was a slight decrease. Mexicans constitute the most excluded group in comparison with other groups. Slightly worse than Central Americans, not too far, but really, really far from, three times higher than the African American population, four times higher than the non-Hispanic US-born whites, and 2.5 times higher than the rest of the immigrant groups. So, as I said, Central America reports slightly lower percentage of uninsured, but it's a very high number as well, 49%, and 52% for Mexican population. This lack of coverage increases also with the recently arrived Mexican and Central American immigrants. Over 6 out of 10 that just arrived to the country don't have health insurance. Mexican, these are just kind of like snapshots of those numbers. Mexican immigrant women are more likely to have health insurance than men. Also, various reasons. Sometimes the fact that some states like Washington give wider coverage for women than in the case of men. The lack of health insurance among Mexican immigrants is accentuated in the 18 to 19 year age group, also for obvious reasons, I think. They probably, younger population, don't feel the need to look for health services as much. And of course, the immigration status has a lot to do with that, so the lack of health insurance coverage is increasing among Mexican immigrants without American citizenship. The fact that our population don't get citizenship, even when they have all the requirements to do so, is so, of course, blocking their access to a lot of services, social benefits, and economic benefits. Just over 1 in 4 Mexican immigrants have acquired American citizenship, a proportion that is also below that of Central Americans, which is 32%. And those two groups are way behind the rest of the immigrants from other areas. Again, some of the areas that I don't want to get into too much detail with these, but some of the areas in which Mexican immigrants are employed are the highest risk types of work for them, the construction and agricultural work. 72% of Mexican construction workers and 66% of those engaged in agriculture and unskilled service jobs don't have health insurance. And those are the areas where more accidents have been reported or sicknesses have been reported. So it makes them even more vulnerable. There you have some of the states, a breakdown of the insured per state, some of the most representatives. And use of health services. Mexican immigrants frequently have no usual source of health care. They don't have insurance, but they also don't have a home clinic or a usual provider. They don't attend regular checkups, or they don't have access to preventive services. It's again higher than in Central America, but both groups are really close. Mexicans use public health centers and clinics more often, but as you can see, the numbers are still lower. 34% and 22% from immigrants for other regions. And again, women are more prone to using services than Mexicans, than men, sorry. Mexican children and adolescents are less likely to meet minimum health standards because of the same reason. They don't have a usual home clinic, and they don't go until the health problem is already very, very advanced. Only 7 out of 10 Mexican adults report their health as poor visit the doctor, and Mexican immigrants visit a doctor less frequently than other groups. These are graphics for dental services and other kinds of services that the Mexican population always ranks below average in receiving these services. Many studies document that immigrants tend to arrive in the U.S. healthier than the U.S.-born population, but that their health generally declines over time. This is something that has been really studied and proven several times. The change in their way of life, the change in their eating habits, and the fact that they don't see a doctor here. Again, some examples: immigrants and African Americans have the highest likelihood of low birth weights in comparison to non-Hispanic US-born whites. Mexican immigrants, adolescents, have the highest weight in relation to their height. Approximately 8 out of 10 Mexican men and 7 out of 10 Mexican women are overweight or obese. Hispanic adolescents have the second highest percentage of treatment for depressive episodes. And Mexican adults reported the highest increase in persons diagnosed with diabetes. This is a little picture of the main needs that our community have and that we try to respond to via some of the programs that we have at the Consulate of Mexico and by partnering with local agencies here. So also our population has been recording higher rates of new cases of HIV and cervical cancer. And so this takes me to the program that we have at the Consulate, which is the Health Window. We have, as I said, 50 consulates all over the US. And by 2 years ago, we completed the process of opening a health window in every consulate that we have. So what this is just a resource center, a referral center, that works differently in each community, in each consulate, depending on the receptiveness of the community, the network that we're able to partner with, the work of a lot of volunteers, because this program works in great measure thanks to volunteer work. We have a budget that is provided by the Ministry of Health every year. And we have a partner agency here that helps us manage those funds. Here in our case is CIMAR Community Clinics. And but the rest of the programs or the services that we're able to provide is thanks to the alliances that we form with local institutions, like even the UDOP, that we have a lot of work with them, insurance companies, other community clinics. Even private providers. So this information is in the booklet that you have now. So I just wanted to show you that We offer the primarily we offer some screenings at the consulate. Here we offer blood, glucose, cholesterol, and BMI screenings. We have a nurse Mondays and Fridays that provides these services to everybody. This is one of the very few services of a Mexican consulate that can be provided to any citizen. We don't exclude any nationality. We actually serve a lot of nationalities other than Mexican. They can go to the consulate without an appointment and get their screening. We have the nurse from CIMAR there that interprets. It's not actually a consult, but interprets the results for them and gives them some advice to change their habits. This is where we have been detecting a lot of new cases of diabetes. Probably the immigrants had this illness before they came here, but they had never been diagnosed. And the change of habits here has accentuated the problem. So some younger adults are also getting diagnosed, and they had never been to the doctor or had this kind of screening before making contact with the health window at the consulate. From there, if the case if it goes beyond just having to change some eating habits or exercise a little bit more, and we detect a serious case, even blood pressure, we have been getting readings that are through the roof, so we are able to refer them to community clinics or to the public health system and try to encourage them to establish a home clinic. We also have twice a month HIV testing and once a month mobile dental clinic. This is a collaboration with Medical Teams International that you work with too. This February 25th will be at Casa Latina with a team from your school and a team from the consulate offering these services. This is the first time that we take it outside. All these kind of services depend on how we are able to partner with somebody. So what we regularly do is to have the clinic at the consulate on a weekday during the morning. Regularly is 8 to 2. The van parks outside the consulate, and we have appointments set up, but we also take walk-ins. And we've been able to serve a lot of people like that. These are some numbers from 2016. The ones on the left are the general numbers from all the 50 health windows, but in our case, in 2016, we served over 7,000 patients or people. And when I say we served them, we gave them information on health issues. Sometimes it goes beyond health issues, and we talk about labor rights or right now about their immigration rights or human rights, but it's people that went to the health window and received some kind of orientation or referral. But of that number, over 2,000 were able to get screened, as I said, many of them for the first time. So dental patients, this is a collaboration that started in 2014. We're very happy that it's a very, very requested service at the consulate. Some of the population that has basic medical insurance for sure is not gonna have dental or vision. We're still working on vision, some kind of vision screening for them regularly. But for now, the dental is the one that has been able to serve 149. And the estimated value of the services that we provided is close to $90,000, which of course doesn't have any cost for the patient. Again, these are some of the numbers for the whole of the health windows. I will say Giselle was instrumental in starting that program at the consulate, and we are very grateful for the work that she did before with the previous model and way less resources than we have now. And these are some pictures we also offer. On October, we have even more services. We have the mammogram van in collaboration with Susan G. Komen of Puget Sound. We do the screenings every day during 3 weeks of the month of October. We have more clinics, and we try to go outside also to promote more physical activity. In this case, a picture you see is of a group in South Park that was that started a basketball league, and we were supporting their efforts and also doing some screenings at the beginning of the tournament and also at the end when they had followed a complete program of trying to change their eating habits and exercising regularly, not only during the league. So we are able to compare results and see the change in their blood pressure or in their glucose and cholesterol levels. There you have a new website. It just kicked off this month, Juntos por la Salud, Together for Health, and that is a view of all the activities that every health window in the country does. We have also some mobile units now, so what we call second generation health windows, and they started in the states that you see over there, Portland, California, Kansas, New York. They have now units similar to the MTI dental unit where they can provide a full consult and some more other services besides the screenings. So they take a doctor on board, and they are traveling to different communities, especially rural communities where people have more problems accessing the services at the consulate. And I think that's it. Of course, on the challenges that we have at the health window is, first of all, the resources are never enough. We have an increasing number of immigrants or Mexican origin people that need services, that need orientation, navigating a system that is very different from the one back home. And so that's, I would say, the main challenge: resources, finding or recruiting volunteers, and of course offering more services according to the needs that we are detecting in the community. And then I would let Giselle talk to you about another effort in serving the vulnerable communities, which is Latinos Promoting Good Health.
Hello, everybody. And my voice goes in and out as well because we're both battling the virus, but hopefully it'll stay for a little while. So my name is Giselle Zapata Garcia, and I actually work at Molina Healthcare in the Community Engagement and Outreach Department. But the hat that I'm wearing today is representing Latinos Promoting Good Health as a co-founder and co-chair. And the Consulate of Mexico has been a wonderful partner from the very beginning. And so we really appreciate having this opportunity to share a little bit about the work that we do alongside. So Latinos Promoting Good Health originally was kind of came together in around 2010, and it really was an effort amongst several different professionals that felt that there was a real need to continue to provide services to the different communities. And so we actually, some of us were involved with the original Latina Healthcare, which started in, the planning started in 2002, and the first one actually was executed in 2003. It took a year to plan that first one. So we all had a bit of expertise in providing health fairs in a way that was really culturally appropriate, relevant, and filled the needs of the communities that we were serving. And so we figured we would continue to do this in a smaller scale in different communities so that it would be easier to facilitate not only access, but getting folks in their communities connected with the individuals that were providing services in those specific communities. So we do find that there continues to be a need to provide these free services, which include the health screenings, connection to resources locally, and then educating them on how to take charge of their health. And that's a component that I think is really important. We try to make sure that we bring in all the partners that help fill all of these needs, because one group can't do it alone, which is why collaborations and partnerships are so valuable. And that includes with student groups as well. And so that's something that we appreciate the time that you all provide to the efforts that we're doing in the community. So it is a collaborative effort between representatives from community-based and for-profit organizations, including federal, state, and local health and safety agencies, as well as local university medicine and pharmacy students with the main goal to organize and convene family health and safety fairs throughout the state of Washington that strive to improve the health of communities residing in Washington state. So I'm sure you guys are all familiar with health fairs, and there's a different way of doing them depending on who's organizing it. And one of the things that we believed was really important when we started the separate was to work with a lot of the faith-based organizations. And that's how it initially started, but it was not just a success, but there was a lot of interest from other groups. And so we currently provide as many services as we can, but expect that there will be partnerships that will be involved. And so, for example, the statewide committee includes Molina Healthcare, Puget Sound affiliate of Susan G. Cohen for the Cure, Medical Teams International, which you all work with, Puget Sound Clean Air Agency, Consulate of Mexico, New York Life, the Washington Department of Labor and Industries, Migrant Coalitions Network, OSHA, Al Shifa, who's part of UGov, the School of Pharmacy, the School of Medicine, Seattle University School of Nurses is also now involved, Actitud Latina, which is actually a program on TV Azteca, and then we have the non-group for the Western Washington chapter as well. And what happens is that we have the statewide committee, but we then work with the local groups. So we identify which communities we will be able to serve and have the capacity for. And then this is an example of some of those local organizations that we then partner up with, and they become part of that planning committee that actually helps execute the event. And so as you can see, it's a real variety. We've got obviously some of the bigger players such as CMAR and Public Health. SOAR tends to focus on children and families. We have local hazardous waste and how that affects your environment, your health and the environment as well. YWCA in their group had focused on women's health, for example. Mason General Hospital also did women's health as well as their clinic system that they have. And so as you continue to see on the list, all kinds of partners, Goodwill, Familias Unidas, South River Neighborhood Center, Jubilee Reach, and then the several churches that we have continued to work with, and as well as educational groups. And we will continue to work with all of these groups, and the idea is to also be able to provide them a toolkit that they can then continue to do the work forward within their own communities. And then at each health and safety fair, we do have, thanks to Molina Healthcare equipment for the blood pressures, the BMI, the glucose and cholesterol. But we do strive to include other free health screenings, so the PAPs and the mammograms. We depend on the Breast and Cervical Colon Health Program to help work with us on that, as well as the mammographers and Komen, dental with the Medical Teams International, as well as volunteer dentists out in the community and students such as yourself to help make that available. And when I say screenings, we do want to have screenings, but that health education piece is extremely important as well. And so we've had student groups come and do just presentations and workshops for those who are waiting their turn to get their screenings. We had a group from the UW that did some vision as well at a couple of the health fairs. We had child developmental screenings, osteoporosis, and HIV testing. And then because we are trying to create an avenue for folks to be able to get on health insurance if they are eligible, then we want to make sure that we have those individuals that are co-navigators that can assist them with getting onto health coverage so that they know not just that they have health coverage, but how to use their health coverage, how to navigate the healthcare system. And then in the fall, we partner up with Walgreens to do free flu shots. Molina Healthcare pays for the flu shots in some cases, but the participant actually received them for free. And then, thanks to New York Life, we also are able to do free child ID kits for all the children so that they actually have a digital fingerprint, their photo taken on the spot, measured and weighed, and the parents get to keep two copies. God forbid anything happened to their child, but that's something that's, again, a safety issue that families get to participate in learning about as well. And then just in 2016, we had a total of over 2,200 participants in 12 health fairs. Of those 781 basic health screenings were provided, 106 PAPs and mammograms, 73 dental patients with 216 procedures. So with dental, we really have to depend on volunteer dentists, and that has been a little bit of a struggle. And so we're not able to have dental at all of the health fairs, but of the ones we did, we were able to serve quite a few individuals. And then we had 117 flu shots and 151 child ID cards. And the uninsurance rate varies from event to event, but it is on average over 50%, some more, some a little under, depending on the whether it's in a rural area or not. And you know, one of the issues that is really important, and Vivian brought it up, is just the immigration status piece, because if you're not here legally, then you have very limited options as to how to access healthcare. And so having the health fair, we stress to folks, is not to replace going to the doctor. It's really to get them connected to the services, make sure that they have an opportunity to learn a little bit more about different health conditions, and help them take charge of their own health. And so it's really important that although we do have the piece of helping them get onto health coverage if they are eligible and how to navigate the healthcare system, we at the very least want to make sure that they step away from that event, understanding where to go after the event and what potential concerns may have come up that day. And this is just a little image of some of the different committee members that we currently have on the statewide committee. And this is our Facebook page where we post lots of photos. I kind of picked just a few, so please feel free to go to the Facebook page, because there's hundreds of photos there. And then if you do have any questions after this, please feel free to send them an email. And I just want to really thank the Consulate of Mexico, because one of the things that long before I started Latinos Promoting Good Health, and long before I was at Molina Healthcare, I was really impressed with the fact that the Consulate of Mexico cared enough to really put funds and be in staff to be involved in really making a difference in the lives of our underserved and vulnerable populations here in Washington. So I want to thank you very much, Lilia, because she's doing the greatest work. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you guys for your attention. I don't know if you have any questions for us, so we could try to answer. Yes?
If immigrants sign up for the Seguro Popular,
Seguro Popular?
Yeah, that. Are they able to receive health care in the United States under that insurance model from hospitals here?
No. That has been a long discussed issue. It's a matter of funds. What Seguro Popular is type of insurance that the Mexican government started recently. We are able to cover many, the coverage is very, very wide, but it's only in Mexico. And what it's been working for is more for immigrants, head of the family that is here and is able to insure the family that stayed home. Because if the person is not working in Mexico, they don't have access to the public health system, like the other options that are the social security clinics. So this was the answer to that. The immigrant that is not in that system can then go through a process of a social and economic study and enroll their families back home. When he goes back home, if he goes back home, he's already in that system and can receive all the services immediately. But we don't have the funds to cover them here in the U.S. It's a very different system, and even the exchange of information between both the Mexican and the U.S. system is proven difficult. It's an issue that we're trying to solve, but for now I don't think there is something in the works for the near future.
I was going to make a comment that the Latina Health Fair that the UW School of Dentistry has been involved with since the beginning, I think, is actually that was, you were at the beginning planning committee. So we've been working actually with Giselle for years, and so
yeah.
It's been a great collaboration, so we thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to serve the community, because you know, the Hispanic community is, they're part of the billion-dollar agriculture industry of Washington, and so it wouldn't exist a lot without the hard work of the immigrant population. And the same thing goes for construction at big time level and at daily home construction. So Casa Latina is a center for day laborers, so that people who want to get help, like doing backyard projects and things like that, can get help right at the place at Home Depot. You'll see a lot of them out there, but Casa Latina is a place that makes sure about workers' rights and has services for them so that they can you know, learn English, learn computers, and you know, just sort of advance themselves. And it's a community center for them. And so those are the people who we will serve when we go to Casa Latina, and then obviously the community that comes to the Mexican Consulate. So thank you for, you know, educating us more about that, and for the opportunity to serve the community.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Yeah. Is there any other questions? Okay, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.